ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, ambassadors, madam, it's a delight for me to be able to welcome you here in the holy halls of Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton University, and particularly in the name of the Liechtenstein Institute on Self-Determination, whose chair I am, and I am very pleased to welcome you also in the name of Professor Cecilia Rausch, who is Dean of the Woodrow Wilson School, but who has to be actually in Washington now, but who follows not only our LISD's activities with great interest, but particularly the initiatives which are run by Dr. Beth English in my institute, and that is on the protection of civilians and women on the one hand, and now children in armed conflict. I have been teaching in these halls here since nearly 25 years, but I have rarely had the occasion to open a seminar with so profound interest stemming from emotional intellectual curiosity than this subject, which in my professional life has changed my professional interests. I became witness to an accident with a claimer mine with a 12 and 14 year old in Bosnia under combat conditions in 1994. And I have seen countless of situations concerning children, from the federal territories in Pakistan to Afghanistan to Chechnya, and now to Syria and its neighborhood. And it's for me particularly fitting, in a negative sense, that we have this seminar on a day when the alert calls come out from my friends in and around Syria of devastating climatic situation. If you have a country with roughly 25 million, where nearly 8 to 9 million refugees are internally displaced, incidentally, for those of you, there are not yet too many students of mine here, this is the size of Switzerland, then it just shows you on what level we are speaking here, especially if we speak about, I dare say 60 to 70% of children under the age of 20, I think it was 70%. The importance of this seminar is, as I discussed it with Beth this morning, I consider this very much in the spirit of the Liechtenstein colloquia. Today we are on record, tomorrow we are private and by invitation only, as a taking stock, as a realistic assessment of the challenges which children are exposed to in armed conflict and in conflict as such. And by those challenges, which include anything from harm, bodily harm, to also psychological stress and others, to being exposed to an hitherto not existent level of manipulation, information, misrepresentation on the social media, which for the generations under the 15 years go down today, I would say, till 7-8 years, which has never been lift to that degree as today. That also means that they are exposed to crime and to suffering in what they might consider life, in real life, when they see it in direct YouTube or other transmission on the web. And I have many times argued that the importance of de-traumatization, the importance of having the young and youngest ones who have experienced all levels of brutality against life, but also psychological dimensions. This notion of de-traumatization is of ultimate importance. but also for building a viable community and society post-conflict. The reason why I emphasize this here in this August halls is because no, I oppose, if somebody would say, children and the fate of children, the fate of women, the fate of civilians in armed conflict is only a human rights dimension. No, it is an utter strategically relevant dimension in the international system. Why? Because children represent our, their, and everybody's future. And what young ones and youngest ones experience, and I come from the city of Freud, may shape their life forever. And radicalization and the propensity to use arms is typically also shaped by the experiences in your childhood and youth. And so any of my friends who deal with hard strategic interests, I say, protecting children in armed conflict and dealing with children in conflict is much more than soft power and soft attraction. It really means to deal with all the elements of a peaceful, stable, and sustainable society where groups of all beliefs and all ideological orientations can live together, and conflict is certainly not a means to solve the issue. I understand that we are going to discuss various elements, how children are going to be exposed to violence, from the actual recruitment for being combatants to the bodily harm, to sexual violence, but also to attacks of schools and hospitals, and basically to the denial of basic human rights and assistance. And I therefore appeal to the participants, and we all will contribute our share to create, in the spirit of Princeton tomorrow and today, a realistic assessment and earnest picture of the challenges and of the problems and the specter and the dimensions of these issues, but also of the actors, which I'm sure are not only state actors or state-based actors, but many times non-state actors, and as I love to call them, even powerful individual actors who were engaged here in actions which do not help this agenda to move forward positively. With all this, I wish this gathering the best for the elaborations, and I would like to express my hope that the spirit of Princeton in the spirit of all nations and in the nation service would really be here a leitmotif which brings about us to a, joining for an effective and really meaningful step forward in protecting children in armed conflict. Let me now begin and offer the floor to the panel, and it is my distinguished pleasure to welcome Madame Serugli, who is the Special Representative of the United Nations Secretary General on Children and Armed Conflict, and she was appointed Special Representative on this level of being Under Secretary General in September 2012, and I'm delighted, Madam, to welcome you to the Law School at Princeton University.
Thank you. I think many are very familiar and friendly faces. Thank you to Ambassador Lucas to be here, our friend, Ambassador de la Sabia, Jovi, and all of you. I think that it's for me very I'm very delighted to be here with you and to share with you some of our thoughts. I'm sure that tomorrow you will discuss in a more the issue that you already identified. And let me start by thanking those who made this gathering possible, and we appreciate that you can continue to support our work and actively watch this issue of conflict, but also that the permanent mission of Liechtenstein to the United Nations and the Liechtenstein Institute on Self-Determination in Princeton University that have managed to organize this meeting. I would like just to remind all of us to return back to 1996, where the Security Council framework to address the issue of children armed conflict was still in the distant future. Graça Machel, all of you knew her report to the General Assembly called children a unifying force capable of bringing us all together in support of a common ethic. This very gathering might serve as an example, a government, an NGO, an academic institution, jointly bringing together stakeholders of the children and armed conflict agenda from diverse backgrounds to enable critical and unbiased discussion. I'm looking forward to interesting discussion and to the result and input we will take away with us. I think that this opportunity that we have is also to allow us to have to use your thought and also the issue that we try to advance in the Security Council, in the General Assembly, but in the area where we have we are facing the challenge. And I hope that this opportunity will be used to address the issues that are on the agenda. And I'm thinking particularly strengthening the implementation of the UN Children Armed Conflict Agenda. And also, I would like you to help us to, we have the opportunity to have our representative of the Security Council, but also to strengthen how we can use our advocacy and help the implementation of the agenda in the Security Council. This is extremely important. And also, I believe that whenever policy, methodology, guidance may contribute to this endeavor, cooperation, partnership by all actors involved have to be at their core. I'm also thinking about how we can, all of us, have a partnership on a holistic and also concerted approach, because this is will help us to better react to situations like, for example, what we are witnessing today in Central African Republic. We all of us, for a while, talking about the risk what will happen. Today, we are receiving alarming information and we are witnessing thousands of children that have been killed, raped, recruited as child soldiers in 2013, but also we are seeing schools, hospitals have been attacked, looted, or used for military purposes throughout the country, depriving children of safe haven when they need them the most. And we are really following the situation in Central African Republic with great concern. We are receiving daily information. We have a team already on the ground, and maybe some of you are already aware that we are on our way, I'm traveling to South Central African Republic in the coming days. And we would like really that this visit and our presence at the working level, not only us but myself, but also Adam Adyeng, the Secretary General of Advisor on Genocide, and also there, we assess the situation, we advocate on the way to protect children and their family, and we enforce the call for robust response from the UN, but particularly also from the Security Council and from the African Union to protect children in Central African Republic. I think another issue that I know that you will discuss and I would like to emphasize is the partnership that we try, my office and other offices, to pursue, and that will be among our priority for 2014. And particularly, I would like to highlight two examples. One is the guidance on 1998, resolution 1998-2011 on attacks on schools and hospitals, and also the how we can end the military use of school, the practice of military use of school. As you know, we are in the process of finalizing with UNICEF jointly this guidance and also our proposal on how we can work on military use of schools, and we would like to, it will be discussed and tomorrow I think we will have a, you will discuss this issue, and I hope you will also help in building the partnership. Because even if people don't intend to attack schools, even if it is not a trigger for listing, but the situation, when it comes to war, in every setting, schools are in, are either attacked or used. And it's almost in every conflict it's the same. And when I was in DRC, it is like we arrive in the village, the only building standing is the school, and we go and walk by the school. And this not only violates international humanitarian law, sometimes not, but it affects the access to school in area where people don't have a full access to school. So I hope that this will be our priority and we'll try to work together and see how we can impact. Second priority that we put on our agenda, and you are aware of, is also launching the campaign to end the recruitment and use of children by government armed forces by 2016. This campaign will be also jointly with UNICEF, and we would like to use it to highlight the effort, challenge, and progress by government concerned in their struggle against the recruitment and use. The partnership of UN with various UN partners, regional and interregional organizations, civil society, and member states. I think this is really an opportunity, and we would like to have you on board because this will allow us to address so many issues. And not only to end the recruitment, but also to prevent it, not only in the 8 countries that are on the list, but it will be also an opportunity to gather a universal agreement that we don't need any more children in any armed or workforce, or armed forces, or even armed groups. And this will be an opportunity to prevent future. So I would like to need to have you on board on this. And of course, the 2016 campaign also is an opportunity when it comes to build national capacity, because what we are doing in every country is that we are working also on how we can build the national institution that can prevent the recruitment, that can fight the impunity, and also protect children. So I'm looking forward to see how we can work with this, how we can also ensure the support of the Security Council, and I'm sure that with the next, with the March debate that Luxembourg accept to put it on the agenda when they preside the Council, will be an opportunity to see how we can advance on this.
are already working on that. Another issue that I would like to share here is regional organization. And we would like to have them on board for this campaign. We signed recently a declaration of intent with the African Union, the Peace and Security Commission, and we would like to use this new partnership that we are implementing in cooperation with UNICEF to contribute strongly to have the policy, the framework, but also the support to end the violation against children and develop respective governments and meaning to the African peacekeepers that, as you know, are more and more involved in Africa in the context of the peacekeeping. Another issue that I would like to raise is the bilateral military assistance and technical cooperation when it comes to what we are trying to achieve either in Africa or in other places, is to know, to see how we can also use this as entry point to strengthen our work. And I also hope that the Security Council will continue to support the mainstreaming of children and armed conflict in the mediation activities, but also in peace processes whenever the respective contexts seem feasible. I think that more has to be done also to ensure a separation and the integration of children. You know that this is the major weakness when it comes to work on how to ensure sustainability of what we could achieve by the separation to ensure that children are not recruited. And it's not only that we have to find a way out for children, but we have also to secure the area where we reunify children from recruitment and relapse in conflict. So this is a major challenge. Not only we need funding for reintegration, but we need to ensure that children are not recruited and are not reunified, even though their family will not be able to protect them. Apart from such a trying point, I would like also to ask you to identify in general ways on how to engage non-state actors. This would be always something on our agenda. We would like, they are the majority on our list. They are the one, even in area where we don't have government recruiting children, in every relapsing conflict, non-state actors recruit children and commit also violation and perpetrate violation against children. So we would like really to work on this issue and to use every opportunity and cross-cutting priority to work during 2014 on non-state actor, and we would like to ensure that even when we are working on our campaign of 2016, we will address the issue of non-state actors. That's, I think, another issue that I would like to mention here is sexual violence in every conflict. We always focus on recruitment, which is a major violation. We have, of course, the maiming, the killing, the attacks on schools, as I mentioned, but sexual violence is really affecting in every conflict and every place we visit or we work on children, boys and girls, because sometimes we consider that sexual violence is a women issue or is a girl issue. It's of course girls, but it's also boys. And when you talk to the former child soldiers, they always say that while they are used for different activities, they are also used sexually and abused by their commander. So this is something that we would like, and it is really widespread. And in every conflict, we have to make sure that we knew how we can gather information, because it was always underreported also. And people either are scared or also because of the stigmatization. And when I was in DRC last just my last visit, we have girls of 14, 15 with babies returning from the bush. So this is a reality that we would like to. Another issue, and I will stop, another issue is the detention. And the detention of children is also something that in every conflict, and we would like you to think how we can address this scourge, because they are always arrested, tortured, ill-treated, either because perceived or effectively associated with armed groups, but sometimes also as a hostage to punish the other from the other side, or also to get information from them, or to use their language. So detention is something that is also in every conflict, and we knew that the major challenge that we have in Syria now. So I think that these are the issues that I thought it's important that I share with you, and I would like just to mention that this is in every conflict that we are seeing. These are the issues that you can find. Maybe sometimes some are more in some area than other, but these are issues that we are mentioning. So as we are in Princeton, and we are in a place where Albert Einstein teaches, so I think that it is important just to say something that he said about children. And I think that he said politics is for the present, but an equation is something to eternity. I'm not as fascinated as with mathematical equation as Einstein was. However, the spirit of these words should guide us in moving forward with children and armed conflict agenda. And I would like also to say that politics may be for the present, but the principle that children shall be protected from harm and suffering in all circumstances, especially in times of conflict, is a universal value that brings us together. I hope it is in this spirit that we will continue our partnership in 2014. And I would like just to add to what you said, that our children are our future. I always also mention that in all the conflict setting that we have today, we have a population, a young population, with a pyramid of age like this. And in some countries, they are sometimes the under 18 are the majority. In some area, they are even very far, more than just the majority. And I heard that in Central African Republic, for example, they are about two-thirds of the population.
Two-thirds.
Yes. So that's something that means that what we are, when we talk about children, we are not talking about small portion of the population. In all the conflict setting, we are talking about the future, but we are also talking about the majority of the population. So we need to ensure that the centrality of this issue, and we need to ensure that this is something that we put not only it's central in the area where it is, but it must be in peace and security, and we are very glad to have the Security Council on board for that, but we need also to ensure that in mediation particularly, because unless you put this in also the mediation, in peace processes, that you ensure that those who are recruiting children and abusing children will not benefit from this and get ranks and get also political gain. We have to ensure that they are criminals and they will be treated as such. So that's how I'd like to speak. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I found it actually touching. Thank you very much, madam, that you mentioned Albert Einstein, who taught right away. It was Woodrow Wilson who actually was the League of Nations, one of the foundations of the UN. And a place like this university lives, breathes, and works for the children.
That's
right. And this is our mission. It's now my distinguished pleasure to introduce and give the floor.
very pleased and honored to participate in today's panel discussion, and which covers the important subject of strengthening the implementation of the UN's children and armed conflict agenda. And I would also like to seize the opportunity first to warmly thank Watchlist Children Armed Conflicts, Permanent Mission of Liechtenstein, and the Liechtenstein Institute on Self-Determination at the University of Princeton for organizing and convening another workshop in 2013. The first Princeton workshop was in February on the issue of persistent violators. Was very fruitful, and the ambassador of Liechtenstein had the opportunity to present the results also to the working group and on the 20th May of this year. And some of the measures discussed here in Princeton in February on a very windy, snowy day were actually integrated, found their way, and we managed to get them also incorporated in the presidential statement adopted by the Security Council on 17th June 2013. So and we will see how the result of this workshop eventually also can feed into the resolution which we are hoping to adopt in March at the occasion of the open debate on children and conflict under the presence of the Security Council. I think I was asked to a little bit from the perspective as chair of the working group to speak about means of strengthened implementation of the agenda on children and armed conflict, and so also to describe a little bit what we are doing, and I'm very humble to do so in the presence of the father of the working group, and also the father, if you wish, of the toolbox on the possible actions for the working group. And I think I would start this by saying that I think the toolbox still is very relevant today. A number of the suggested actions have become standard practice, are taken up regularly in the working group conclusion. Actually, the majority of the actions proposed in the toolbox. Some others have been implemented more unevenly. But I think it also is that it's very much stressed at the beginning of the toolbox that this is supposed to be a living document, that there is not one size fits all, that everyone has to adapt, and I think the way the toolbox has been used also reflects that. Since assuming the chairmanship of the working group this January, Luxembourg has driven really to mainstream the carbon agenda in all relevant aspects of the work of the Security Council, with exactly a view of strengthening further the implementation of the UN's children and armed conflict agenda. And I would like perhaps to, if you allow, to quickly run through the main areas of work and also try that to identify where further deepening can happen. And I think that SG already has announced quite a few of the big, more substantive agenda points also where we will have to continue working on next year and in the years to come. First main area is certainly the establishment of mandates or the renewal of mandates. This offers to the opportunity, the possibility also for the Security Council to promote child protection issues in peacekeeping operations, special political missions, by including inter-alia specific language on child protection issues, on child protection capacities, on the monitoring and reporting mechanism, but also more and more on the disarmament, demobilization, reintegration of children affected by armed conflict, on the need for including provisions on child protection issues in peacekeeping, in peace negotiations and peace agreements. And so we have tried, as chair of the working group, also my delegation has systematically worked when these negotiations are ongoing in the Security Council on establishing new mandates, for example, like now Central African Republic, which was adopted last week, the new the mission there, but also where renewing mandates. So we have tried systematically to strengthen the language on child protection issues in country-specific resolutions and also in presidential statements. And for example, I just mentioned the resolution on Central African Republic, resolution 2127, we were able to include language on the disarmament, demobilization, reintegration of children associated with armed forces and groups, as well as language on the exclusion of perpetrators of violations and abuses against children from the security sector. There is also provision, and I will come back to that later, there is also a provision in this resolution, which is very clear on, that there can be targeted sanctions against not only those who are creating difficulties for the political process, who act to undermine the peace in Central African Republic, but also for all those who fuel violence, including, and I read the text of the resolution, including through violations of human rights and international humanitarian law, the recruitment and use of children in armed conflict, in violation of applicable international law, sexual violence, supporting illegal armed groups. So you have it as a marker very much that this will also be potential criteria, the recruitment and use of children, and I think the, as she spoke about, the wave problem in Central African Republic on these issues. We try in my mission very much in order to be able also to set to mainstream this concerns on this agenda. We have established systematic exchanges internally in the mission between our my colleagues who deal with the issue of children in conflict and our regional desks. So that our CAC experts advise their colleagues dealing with geographic issues while providing them specific relevant information. Also, always in my background, for every consultation of the Security Council, I always have one part on what's the situation of children and armed conflict. And also, by providing the colleagues with specific language proposals they can make in negotiations and, you know, with arguments and also to support it, so that we can really try to mainstream this issue and having this more horizontal cross-cutting approach. And this might be perhaps a little bit easier in a smaller mission like mine, but I think increased mainstreaming represents an important contribution to strengthening the agenda, because we see very often that, you know, then perhaps sometimes one doesn't really know, it's not so concerned about this issue, and then you end up with a text which might not be ideal why one could have has worked on this. Another proposal in the toolbox also is that organization of information and briefing by outside experts. We have also tried to do this in order to provide the members of the working group with complementary information on country-specific situations and to increase also the understanding of the challenges faced by a specific country before we start negotiations on conclusions of the working group. So we, together with watchlist and also crisis action, we have thus organized, for example, a briefing on the LRA in January before taking up the negotiations. Also, before we started with negotiations on Myanmar, we had a briefing from the representative of the ILO, who is a crucial partner also of Myanmar on this issue. And so, to do a little bit, as I said, provide more information. And I would also like to add that we always invite also to this briefing not only the members of the working group, but also the regional desks of the various member states of the Security Council, so again, to perhaps help a little bit mainstream the issues. The idea being, as I said, to provide more information. We also, obviously, these are not outside experts, but we have. have also tried to have the SLST very much brief regularly as a working group on current affairs and also on field trips, as well as on progress made on the implementation of action plans. So for example, Mrs. Sarudi came and gave briefings on the missions to Syria as a region, to Yemen, to Chad, to the DRC. We also had briefings from her on the implementation of the action plan signed with Chad, as well as on the situation of children in Mali and in the Central African Republic. And we will also, we didn't manage yet this year, we will also try next year, we thought also to do perhaps through VTC to get more briefings also from the field, also from relevant personnel from UN missions, and I think we will try to start with South Sudan, where we tried already also a lot of issues to discuss. So then the specific field trips by the working group. And since this has also been identified as an important means for the working group, for the members to gain first-hand knowledge, information, and so we have building also on the experience of previous chairs, we undertook this year, actually last week when we came back, the working group undertook a trip to Myanmar from the 29th of November to the 5th of December. This was a really very fruitful trip, very constructive, and this was also to really discuss on the ground, give a follow-up to the conclusions which the working group adopted in August 2013 on the situation of children of conflict in Myanmar. And we plan also to organize again next year such a trip to an African country and most likely South Sudan. So that's this information for the members of the working group. And during our recent visit to Myanmar, I could really experience myself the relevance of such trips. I think relevance for all involved, relevance for the members of the working group who can, you know, see how the conclusions translate on the ground. Relevance also, I think, for look at the representative of Myanmar is here, for the authorities also involved, because it gives an opportunity to interact also with the working group, to speak about the progress, but perhaps also to discuss freely about the challenges which still exist, but also with the UN team on the ground, you know, the monitoring and reporting team, the country team, because also we felt very much in Myanmar, they were also very happy to have the opportunity to exchange, to see what could we do more, how could we interact more. So really, I think this is a very important tool which we have to continue. Then added to that, and ensuring also that UN security, the Security Council field trips also take into account the dimension of children and armed conflict. This is a provision also in the toolbox. I think it is important that the council, when the council visits a given country, that one also, if it is of relevance, obviously, that this issue also touched upon. I had myself the opportunity this year to participate already in two visits of the council, one to Yemen and one to DRC, both countries where the issue is relevant. And I had the opportunity to bring the issue up in the Yemen, also with authorities, and in the DRC with authorities very much in the implementation action plan, but also with representatives of civil society active in the area in Goma, had talks there, and also again with the UN monitoring team. And the PSD, which we adopted in June, also we included a reference highlighting the importance that these field trips of the Security Council take into account, and I quote, giving special attention to child protection issues when undertaking its relevant field visits. So this is included also in the PSD, or was reiterated, I think this is important. In general, awareness raising during country-specific consultations of the Security Council. I think regardless of the importance of the working group, and think it is a major achievement that only thematic working group really of the Security Council subsidiary organ is the one on children and on conflict, and it's important that the working group exists. But it is also important to keep the link with the Security Council, because sometimes there is a tendency there, oh, it's a working group, so we don't need to bring this out too much in the Security Council as such. So I think it is important to do also awareness raising in the council as such. We try to do it in all consultations where situation of the Security Council agenda, where the issue of children and conflict is relevant. Luxembourg has drawn the attention of the council and the relevant SOSGs and ESGs to the violations against children, and advocated regularly for the inclusion and also strengthening of child protection units in concerned peacekeeping operations, especially with the missions, as for example in Mali, etc. I also have briefed the council on the adoption and the content of the working group conclusions on LIA and also Yemen. I intend to be also the council on the visit to Myanmar. We also have finally agreement to have the SSG alongside other SSGs included in the briefings to the Security Council on the humanitarian situation in certain countries, and more specifically, for example, in Syria, in order to give also the relevance these issues. And I think also when the SSG comes back from a visit to the African Republic, there might perhaps also be an opportunity in this respect. The SSG spoke about also the relevance of other regional organizations and to try to disseminate children are conflict priorities also in other fora. We have also tried to do so, and we were a bit struck when we were negotiating on the PRST again in June, that we felt a little bit of a resistance to put more specific language descriptions, provisions about, you know, the role of regional organizations in the PRST, because already in 2000, in Resolution 1314, and also in 2001, we had very specific language there in these resolutions, from nominating focal points, nominating units, nominating training. But we seem to have a little bit gone back on that, and now we have to work again on these areas. And I think it is important, like the SSG said, that there's also this agreement which was signed in Addis Ababa, now with the African Union. We tried also to help a little bit on our side there as chair, and we're also trying to mainstream all of these issues in other fora where we are members through our diplomatic missions, also at the level of the European Union, but also our mission in Addis Ababa, and trying also to move these issues more generally forward. Finally, presidential statements, resolutions, obviously this is a means, a tool, especially for the chair of the working group, who can have special responsibility there, who can initiate thematic debates, propose adoption of relevant documents of the Security Council. I mentioned already several times we had the debate, and it was a little bit following the debate also in the working group on the issue of persistent perpetrators, that the Security Council had a debate on 17th June on the report of the SG, but also on more specifically trying to focus on persistent perpetrators, and we negotiated and adopted a presidential statement at that occasion, which addressed this issue in a more comprehensive manner, and also the issue of the action plans, but also the point of the accountability, impunity, and I think we managed there we make also step forward. The language is much stronger than what we had before. And we opted for PST in order to recreate also again the unity of the working group on this issue and of the council on this issue. For next year, it is our intention to hold two open debates actually. One during our presidency, the Security Council in March. and another one on the occasion of the publication of the Secretary General's annual report on CAC. We are not yet sure when exactly we do that. We still have to find the presidency we will take up at that time. But we also aim to adopt a new resolution in March. And we will also organize on the eve of the debates, together with the SSG, an event in support of the Special Representative's campaign to end the recruitment and the association of children with armed forces in the situation of conflict by 2016. One point, perhaps sanctions committees, where it's a little bit relativized, where perhaps some more progress has to be made. Why, as I said, for CAO, we have managed to get the criteria also for recruitment now already foreseen that this should also be, if there are targeted measures, this should be one of the criteria. In general, the whole issue of sanctions committee, targeted measures, is one, I think, where we have not progressed in the last years very much. There is not much interaction there, or not really too much. And was also in June, for them, one of the most sensitive issues to negotiate with the PRST, and where we have basically couldn't move much over beyond agreed language that existed before. So, sorry, I have been a little bit longer than I thought. In conclusion, I would very much subscribe to what SSG said, that it's all about partnerships, also to try to move the issues forward. Various roles, agendas, everybody has its role to play. As chair of the working group, we see very much a dual role of advocate and facilitator, also the one trying to maintain consensus, because this is also the role in the working group as such, to advance agenda. This makes that things sometimes are a little bit more slow to move, but I think it also has its virtue to have everybody on board and to have an agenda which is supported by the membership and continues driving to implement the agenda and work on its also implementation on the ground very much.
Excellent. With this, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce to you all Monsieur Jean-Marc de la Sablière, whom I still remember very vividly in his actions as permanent representative of France to the United Nations and the United Nations Security Council, of course, between 2002 and 2007. That was the time when Austria was presidency of the European Union, and I remember you served. Activities, but I did not know until I was involved in Afghanistan. You were all as founding father of the children and served conflict group and agenda, and I can only wholeheartedly compliment you for this, and so particularly delighted to have you here.
First, thank the Digital Institute of Self-Determination Princeton and also Washington and all the organizer of, I would say, very timely and important workshop for having invited me. It's really a pleasure to be here today and to be part of the ongoing discussion on And I remember very well how I felt when Resolution 1612 was adopted almost 8 years ago now. And I thought it was a kind of an act. And I thought myself I would be able eventually to implement this text. I knew very well what the compromises were on the text since I negotiated. Should we be really able to implement this text with a wide dynamics? And in doing so, make significant and concrete progress to better protect children now or in our world. Well, I think that thanks to Resolution 1612, which really improved the system, which system set up in the previous years, and thanks to the impulse, I think, given when the text was adopted, thanks also to a better, I would say better, I think today is better, better coordination within the UN family, real progress were made from 2005 on. But a few years later, in spite of these progresses, I think that we are still far from our objective. Full implementation is our objective. Last year, the report, in the report, Radhika Kumar asked me to prepare, I have tried to identify both progresses and insufficiencies before making some recommendation. And a year later, a year after this report has been issued, I've taken into account the discussions and negotiations which took place in the Security Council, its publications, taking into account also what has happened in the field. I must say that my assessment has not changed. And I would even add that I am a little worried because of four elements. First, consensus has been lost in 2012. I do not believe. I never believe, and I have been in this business for 15 years, I appear to be councillor, deputy ambassador. I never believe and thought that consensus has to be preserved at any cost. But I always believe that great efforts were needed to maintain unanimity. And I think that great efforts have to be not to maintain unanimity on this agenda without. We saw, obviously, drawing back from what has been agreed upon. Second, though there have been a lot of recommendations made by this report, as well by last year workshop, and other reports such as the excellent discussion paper issued by Watchlist, though there have been some good decisions, and we have listened very carefully to what the matter is at all, though I think that progress has been made also in the field, though all this, I would say, positive elements. I think that there's still a lot of work. And I've been frank, I have been said that only three or four conclusions. try to have more fuel. Because if we don't have enough, then the whole system can be at stake. So I think it's important to make as much as possible. Third, I would say that third reason why I'm maybe a little worried, the positive conclusion I have reached regarding governments pointing out their really valuable efforts to conclude a plan of action with the UN, and I think that beside also, I would say, real progress made on the implementation of some action plan, like I didn't believe it was possible. For example, what has happened in DRC is remarkable, I would say. And I can also say what is positive that's happened. You know, I think that despite all this, you know, I think that there is a lot of work to do, and I very much welcome the initiative of SRG Zerubi to make sure that by 2016 no government and armed force will use child soldier. This is a main progress. When we started the whole, you know, discussed 10 years ago, this issue of many governments will use child soldier. And most of them have signed the plan of action, and with this initiative taken by SRG, we may reach, I think, a good conclusion by 2016. No more of government with any more human child. And this would be a great, great achievement. And I think that we will discuss it in one of our working groups. I think this initiative has received support by all governments, and I think it would. Fourth reason why I'm a little worried, that in spite of the Security Council constant condemnation of all violation of children's rights, these violations have reached an intolerable level in some situations such as Syria and Central Africa. So we're not trying to elaborate on too much on what could be done. I think that assessing the situation and making new recommendations is precisely why we are here. I'm sure that our discussion between working groups will be interesting and we have you. I just wish at the outset of this workshop share with you a few ideas. First, I think we must continue our effort to convince member states that the children and armed conflict agenda must continue to receive the very high priority it deserves. In other words, we need a strong Security Council engagement and involvement. Maybe you haven't seen enough of that in the last year. We need a very, very strong Security Council engagement. And at a time when the international community is facing the terrible consequences of the Syrian conflict and the risk of massive chaos in Central Africa, I welcome the debate which will take place in March. And I see that a debate in the Council, I don't know what the debate will focus on, but I think a debate focusing on the protection of children in some conflicts, these conflicts, and I don't think just one. I think, you know, conflict where the situation is really bad. It's not, the debate is not addressed only one. Some conflict where the situation is really bad. I think it would have a real impact. I think that the media will follow it certainly very carefully. And maybe also UNICEF, since now UNICEF and the Bureau are working very, very closely, UNICEF ambassadors will help convince a large number of governments to increase their support to the new agenda. They have these ambassadors, you know, the UNICEF ambassadors, they have a real impact in public opinion. This is the first idea. And second, I think that improving, second idea, improving the system setup, which has produced some results, remains crucial. But we must be aware chairman is doing an excellent job, or some leader countries, or the main NGO to do that job alone. Only shared action of all these actors, which also require a constant Security Council engagement and support from a large majority of the UN membership, can reach the objective. Well, in the recent year, I have noticed one positive element that the agenda still receives strong support among the UN membership. Now, third idea I want to share with you. I think that we need an ambition, vision, not only a long-term vision, we all have to say long-term vision, to get rid of this, but we need to have a mid-term vision, in other words, a mid-term policy. And it seems to me, this is a good news, that in addition to what I have said about the council engagement, how to improve the system, I think that there is an agreement on three main elements which can be part, since what you have said, both part can be our mid-term policy. First, try to end the association of children with harm. This is a very bad need. This initiative has to be strong. And we look forward to this is a really indication of what she expects from all actors involved, and governments, regional organizations, and so on. Second, make some significant progress in engaging armed non-state actors, resistance perpetrators. I think that a few more action plans must be signed in 2014. To show that the system is working. We all know that non-state actors are a mixed group. I think that the conclusion I have read of your last year workshop, this was underlined, that there is a considerable variety of among these perpetrators. But dialogue with some of them is possible. And I think that identifying these groups and defining a coordinated policy to get at least a few of them signing a plan of action in 2014 requires a lot of consultation. The working group among the leaders, the chairman, the SRG, and some members of the council, defining I think which group could be, could sign in 2004 a plan of action and make pressure on working. Sometimes it's tricky to get this plan of action. Sign, I think, would be a good objective. And government and regional organization can play a major role in helping the SRG and the working group to reach this objective. So I hope we'll discuss that in session. And finally, I think, well, the time has come to make new progress on addressing other violations, and I listened very carefully to what I said regarding sexual violence and the number of school is 192. I don't remember the resolution now. 1992, more 98, I don't remember. Since we have the council has decided that it would be triggered also, then it is really important to have also progress on this. So this can constitute, these three elements and plus having the council. I think this could be important objectives for 2-3 years, and if we could reach this objective, I
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And it's of course the internal truth that the more key organizations are aware, and key institutions in this case are aware of any serious children and armed conflict, the more it can be translated in effective governance policies. But for all of this, it needs advocacy. And I think it fits very much that we can now welcome Joe Baker, the advocacy director of the Children's Rights Group Division in Human Rights Watch, and she has been active in trying to educate and to, I don't want to say spread the word, but at least raise awareness. Welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon. It's such a pleasure to be on a panel with such strong advocates for children, the SRSG, Ambassador Lucas, Ambassador De La Sandiere, and to be part of this discussion about how to strengthen implementation of the Children in Armed Conflict agenda. As we've heard, there's so much to say about this agenda, but I want to focus on just four issues this afternoon. The first is attacks on education and military use of schools. The Security Council has come such a long way from when it started, where its really exclusive focus was child soldiers. And we now have a much broader agenda that encompasses sixth grade violations, including attacks on schools. As the SRSG highlighted, we also have a new challenge, which is the military use of schools. And the Secretary General highlighted this in his report earlier this year, that it's an emerging challenge that really poses particular dangers for children. And I'm really happy that we'll have a whole session devoted to this tomorrow to explore it in more detail. But I did want to highlight a few ways that governments can respond. Since January 2005, armed forces or armed groups have used schools in at least 24 conflicts around the globe that have converted schools into barracks, into detention centers, into bases of military operations, into weapons depots. This military use is not always strictly against international law, but it does have devastating consequences for children. It can turn their schools into legitimate objects of attack. As a result, children are killed, they're injured, their schools are destroyed and damaged. Military use of schools also leads to schools being shut down, increasing dropout rates, and tens of thousands of children being denied their access to education. The Security Council has already called on its members and parties to armed conflict to refrain from any actions that would impede children's access to education. This is really important, but I think that we can go a little bit further. And as we think about 2014, there are a couple of things to consider. One is to call on parties not only to refrain from actions, but to take positive action to prevent the military use of schools. For example, by prohibiting it through their military laws and their regulations. And secondly, is this new initiative that's underway to develop international guidelines to prevent the military use of schools. Many of the governments who are here today have already participated in helping to draft these guidelines, and they're known currently as the Lausanne guidelines. These can really be a powerful tool for preventing schools from becoming battlegrounds and making schools off-limits to military forces. And a firm commitment to such guidelines by member states would certainly take us a long way to allowing children to learn without fear. The second issue I want to talk about picks up things that were mentioned already by the SRSG and Ambassador De La Sandiere, and that's non-state actors. Tomorrow morning we're going to be talking specifically about governments using child soldiers and the campaign being led by the SRSG to make government forces child soldier free by 2016. But I believe that we need to continue to do all that we can to address non-state actors as well. Non-state actors make up the vast majority of the perpetrators on the Secretary General's list, currently 46 out of 55 listed parties. 23 action plans that have been signed to date, actually over half, 14 of them, were signed by Nazi actors. And of the six of these have been fully implemented so far, and the parties were delisted. So in fact, of the eight parties that have been delisted, six of them are non-state actors. So you can almost argue that non-state actors have a better track record of implementation than states. And of the remaining NSAs that are still on the list, a number of them have also, I think 10 by watch lists count, have expressed some form of commitment to ending violations against children. So I hope that we can continue this dual track of focusing not only on government forces, but also on non-state actors. And this can happen if, first of all, member states allow access to non-state actors by the UN in order to negotiate action plans. And then secondly, if the Security Council and the UN continues to make non-state actors a priority and to use the successful tactics that it has already used in other cases to negotiate action plans and ensure accountability. The third issue I wanted to discuss has not really come up so far this afternoon, and that's the issue of peacekeeping missions. In 1998, and I want to take you back a little bit, the UN Secretary General announced a new policy on minimum age of peacekeepers. He announced that from that point forward, member states contributing troops to peacekeeping operations would have to make sure that those troops were at least the age of 18. And he said that his intention was to make sure that the UN set a good example during a time when we were trying to eliminate the use of child soldiers. Now, the peacekeeping forces represent the face of the UN in so many conflicts worldwide. Last December, the UN announced a new policy on human rights screening of UN personnel. And here again, it was intended to preserve the UN's integrity and to make sure that individuals who had committed grave violations of international law were not part of UN operations serving with the UN. I think this principle applies equally to armed forces that are on the Secretary General's list for committing grave violations against children. The SRSG has been a strong principal voice on this issue, and I hope that member states will start to discuss a new policy that peacekeeping operations should not include parties that are listed for grave violations against children. Establishing such a clear policy would not only ensure that the UN's reputation is intact, but would also create an extra incentive for listed parties to get off the list, to be delisted so that they could then participate in peacekeeping operations. And then the final point that I wanted to address, Ambassador De La Sinclair has already mentioned, and that is the working group. It's one of the greatest assets that we have in the Children in Armed Conflict agenda. We owe such a debt of thanks to Ambassador De La Salviere for bringing the working group into existence, and to the previous chairs, Mexico, Germany, and now the able leadership from Luxembourg. The examination of individual countries by the working group has increased scrutiny of their account of their implementation of international standards, and has pushed many parties to adopt and implement action plans. But we have to face that the working group is facing some difficulties. Last year, it only adopted four sets of conclusions, and this year, it's likely that it will only adopt three sets. When the working group was first created, the vision was that it would be considering two reports every 2 months, and would be adopting those conclusions every 2 months. Last year, the average negotiating time was over a year, from the point when the working group first receives its reports. The original goal was to conclude those negotiations in a two-month window. So as Ambassador De La Salviere says, this isn't enough. The pace of country-specific reporting from the Secretary General has also been quite slow. There were only three country-specific reports submitted this year, only two last year. We know that these delays are not a reflection in any way on the leadership of the chair of the working group or the majority of the working group's members. We know that they have a strong commitment to children and to the agenda, and that it's a very small minority that has been obstructing the negotiations in some cases. But this is something that we need to face because it is undermining the effectiveness of the agenda. And it may be time to start thinking about some new working methods within the working group. And as we start to contemplate what they might be, we might look to other parts of the United Nations for some examples. So for example, looking at the methodology at the Human Rights Council in adopting the reports from the Universal Periodic Review, or consulting with treaty bodies on the methods that they use to achieve and adopt their concluding observations on state parties' reviews. Adopting some new methods could help return us to our original goal of timely action and response to the violations that are happening against children. So just to conclude, I think we continue to see many, many positive results from the Children and Armed Conflict Agenda. We have active engagement from UN country teams. We have strong leadership from the SRSG, from the working group, the working group chair. But I think that we can be more, we can do better. And I hope that the four steps that I've outlined today, steps to prohibit the military use of schools, active engagement with non-state actors, and a robust peacekeeping policy that's consistent with UN values, and a more effective working group can take us even further. We've made a lot of significant progress, but I think we can do more. Thank you.
Most importantly, turn over the chairmanship to David Smets, who is the director of Watchlist Children and Armed Conflict, and I do so with the expression of our gratitude, not just for the work you have done, and also together with the Principality of Liechtenstein mission, but also for the vision you have projected in this. And so, Madam.
Thank you very much, and of course, thank you so much to our esteemed panelists who are here today. I think everyone here in the audience must be thrilled to be here today, because really, people who you have here before you, from whom you've heard firsthand, are your most important minds right now within the Children and Armed Conflict Agenda, SRSG Zerogi, Ambassador Lucas, but also representing people who bring a historical perspective to this agenda, Ambassador de la and Joe, who has always been here and always continues.
And eternally, yeah.
It is my role to moderate our discussion going forward. I am recognizant that we are a little bit behind on the schedule. It's already 5 o'clock, and this whole session normally would go only until 5 o'clock. But I hope that especially our dignitaries have just had a little bit more time to stay and take some questions from the audience. Coming here, the question that was asked of our contributors was to contemplate the subject of the workshop. How can we strengthen, going forward, the implementation for the Children and Armed Conflict Agenda? All the different panelists have outlined their views, their visions of what can be done. A few of the items that were mentioned, not just by one, but by a few of the panelists in their own words. First and foremost, of course, the upcoming campaign of the SRSG, bringing an end to recruitment and use of child soldiers by state armed forces by 2016. A realistic goal, a goal that we can actually achieve, ambitious, but also feasible. So certainly that is an item that we can rally behind. Subparts of that also mentioned that it would not only provide an opportunity for delisting, but also really an opportunity to work with various member states on prevention, on capacity building, on institution building within these various countries that would prevent further recruitment from happening in the future as well. A second item that was mentioned by various of the panelists was the importance of partnerships. Not one single institution, not one single stakeholder can achieve the ultimate goal of this agenda alone. but together the sum of the parts can really make an important a difference and a contribution. Some of the subsections mentioned in that, again, regional organizations, what are the particular roles that they can contribute? But also, interestingly mentioned, the role of bilateral actors, that is, your individual governments of representatives that are here today. Interestingly mentioned, how do we use military assistance? How do you use technical assistance? Those may be items to consider going forward as well. Very eloquently elaborated upon by Ambassador Dukas, the importance of mainstreaming, the importance of mainstreaming children in armed conflict in the Security Council. But not only in the Security Council, also a very important aspect mentioned was conflict mediation and peace processes, which exactly is that gateway that can lead us towards the armed groups, also mentioned by various participants in the panels. And maybe perhaps that could be one of those answers to the question that the challenge brought up by SRSG, suggestions of how can we better engage with these armed groups, with particular armed groups, with specific armed groups that may be more open towards this type of dialogue. And then last but not least, other violations. What progress can we make on some of the other violations beyond recruitment and abuse? Sexual violence was mentioned, but also attacks in schools and hospitals, and then most particularly the importance of preventing military use of schools. So a small summary of some of the topics that were mentioned and been brought forward by some of our panelists. But now I think I would like to turn over the floor to the audience and ask you for your vision. What do you think? How do you feel that we can strengthen the implementation of the agenda in the future? Or any other questions that you may have for the esteemed panelists, of course.
Let me break the ice. I would like to ask something out of real profound personal interest. On a conceptual level, is it objectively validated that there is now an increase in children, and I would define children from my own personal perspective as 16 and below, in the conduct of hostilities? Are we having objectively an increase of this, or is only the awareness about it objectively increased? The reason why I ask this is because I think if you try to treat the phenomenon, you have to know the causes of this phenomenon. And the second element I wanted to bring in is the importance of culture and religion in this dimension. Why? Anybody of us who has dealt in Central Asia, Far East Asia, and has realized that the, first of all, age expectancy, secondly, the societal element, pushes the age down to levels which in the developed world, especially in the European Union, would be, or the United States, would be just unacceptable. It really is not common that you have parents here in the age of 15, 16, 17. It's very common if you go with me to Afghanistan or elsewhere in this age. Now that, of course, enhances the propensity that those also take, that the male folk there takes up arms, but also the ladies, but young women, in an age much lower than in our societies. So my question is, do we know causality for the higher perceived quantity of children in armed forces? Yes, and why is this like that?
But I also, last but not least, would like to point out that we
One, first of all, I think that more awareness, no doubt about it. If we have today only 8 government forces that are on the list, and 6 of them already signed an action plan, and the 7th already approved an action plan, that means that also, not only awareness, but also the real kind of consensus, at least at government level, because of the all work that was done, that we don't want to have these children in our army and have a permit. That's one aspect, that there is no government saying today, it's not your business, I have the right to treat children. So every government is saying, I don't want to have children, I have some problems, help me to solve it. So this is, for me, a very a move that was not in the past. And I always give the example when I arrived in DRC in 2008, just 4-5 years ago. And I remember I start by watching Mobutu, president du roi du Congo, king of Congo. And at one time you see in the stadium of Kinshasa, the Kabila father sitting, and you see the Kadugo, the army of children, parody. So I always say, which country can do that today? So I think we have the awareness. Government don't want to have children in their army. They have some problems, those who did not yet finalize all the measures to ensure that. But at the same time, we are noticing that every time you have a conflict, you see that children are recruited, even in, you talk about culture
and religious,
I don't believe so, because I have an example that I always also gave, the Tuareg. The Tuareg don't recruit children, but they did in the conflict in Mali, and they will do in other places. So I think you are, as I said at the beginning, you are in area where the majority of the population is young, so you will certainly go and recruit children. You have also many reasons why children join. Sometimes it's also because in the context, it's not either because way of finding work or, but it's also because sometimes you are, it's very easy to recruit children. It's very easy to manipulate children. And this, my last visit in DRC, children were telling me that their commanders telling them, I prefer recruiting children because they obey orders. So you will always have this context unless you have, as I said, that's why I say, don't allow anyone to benefit from it. And work to make sure that the fight against impunity is effective. Make sure they will not gain ranks, will not be allowed to enter an army to benefit from political. These are things, and that's the sanction committee. Why, for example, it's important that these commanders are identified. We push, if we have an opportunity, to get them on the list of the sanction committee, to get them prosecuted, to have an. This will be the best way to raise awareness and to ensure that people will not do it. But you will continue to have it. Of course, even those who are not recruiting children, they use children as human shield, for example. So all of this is, you have different way of using the children, and we saw it in different contexts. But I don't believe that it's religious or culture. It's just that you are in a context that you have war, that people have to survive, and they have to fight, and the composition of the population is also that many are young. If you have war today in developed country, you will see maybe things happening the same. And I was exposition on the 2nd World War in Nantes, and we have many photo of children at a very low age with acne and with the arms. So I think it's the war, and we have to. This is the root cause. This is the war.
Just on the numbers issue, I think greater awareness of the problem may create an impression that the problem is growing, but in actual fact, the numbers have declined. And it's actually, I think, a product of the success of the agenda. When I helped co-found the Coalition Stop Abuse of Child Soldiers in 1998, we conducted research that estimated that as many as 300,000 children were fighting in about 30 countries. Basically in the mid-1990s. Today, we only have child soldier abuse documented in 14 countries, as opposed to 30. And I, even though there's no current estimates of the number of child soldiers, I seriously doubt it's over 100,000 worldwide at this point.
How do you define children by?
Under 18, international law. Mm-hmm.
May I invite a comment from inside of the community?
Thanks. And just I first want to say, you mentioned that we're thrilled to be able to convene this, and we're thrilled also, and just very passionate about these issues, and very committed. So it's a great opportunity to hear the call to implementation. And we call the list a call to action and a call to implementation, and we are doing it because inside the organization, in order for us to invest as we do in the monitoring and reporting, we use it for our program response, our advocacy, and our prevention. And it's starting to work. I mean, that's how we're now conceiving of it, and it's very interesting. The recent example, of course, is the government chat. It's an unprecedented that an action plan in 6 months can go from stall to, for all practical purposes, it still needs to be maintained, but compliance. So that's now something that we are very, very excited about. The 2016 campaign, it's amazing. It's going to be a real challenge. We know there are countries that are going to be especially challenging, but it is doable, and it's a vision. So that's very, very, very exciting. I wanted to mention one other point last week when the Security Council Working Group convened. And one of the questions that was raised by a member of the group was, what is the role of civil society? Mm-hmm. And I said, I wanted to repeat what UNICEF said in response, is that this agenda is owned by civil society. As Joe just mentioned, it was the vision, and it was the work, and it was a groundswell and grassroots of civil society. And now the Security Council has claimed that agenda, and rightly so. Civil society role and the partnerships there are still the real the life breath of the campaign, the 1998 guidance, and the Senate guidance, all of it really. So that's something else I wanted to do. And also just the recent co-presentation we made at the Child Protection Working Group, where the MRM guidelines and the field manual were co-presented with the Watch List Resource Pack on the MRM, so that, you know, to bring a kind of holistic perspective to what to do next. So, and then just I wanted to say, about the question of prevalence, we're actually about to embark on a global, you know, to look again at the global numbers of impact of armed conflict on children. So that's a challenging one. Indeed, the nature of conflict has changed, so it's hard to measure, because you see the way we conceived of conflict 20 years ago when the Michelle figures were put together, and today it's quite different. And we are very, very much committed to the work with armed groups. It's an increasing challenge. I mean, I'm not going to go into it. It's a very long story, but this is going to remain key focus. And then I want to close with a burning question for me, and it hasn't been raised here today, so I can't resist raising it, though it's a provocative question indeed, and that is the sixth violation, one I think we hear referred to is access. And yet we're sitting here today when one of the conflicts that's raging has a level 3 emergency, which means all hands on deck. There's a country in Syria where we are really common time, since it's all. And what is the international community? What are we all able to do? And that's not only in that conflict, but we see that challenge in ways. And it's a very painful one. So I just wanted to raise that because it's something that I think is of great relevance for the work of the Security Council, which we've been for the watch list, human rights watching. And for the joint work with the SRSG, it's been a terrific year. I mean, we've just had such a breadth of achievement, and we really value it. We're so pleased and we look forward to continuing that for sure.
Thank you very much, Sarah Mingyan. And certainly thank you for placing that challenge of denial of humanitarian assistance out there and the group and the audience as well. I still have the ICC on my list for intervention.
Yes, although my name is Diane Amon, I'm a professor at the University of Georgia. I serve as a special advisor to the ICC prosecutor on children in armed conflict. I'm delighted to be here with my colleague, Shamila Batoghi, who is from the ICC. She is the senior legal advisor to the ICC prosecutor, and so we're very much welcoming this. I should say anything I say is in my personal capacity as an academic lawyer. And I wanted to add another violation that I thought I did not hear, but I've been very curious about the news recently that their children are being targeted as children in conflicts. And of course, killing and maiming is one of the violations. And so it's of interest to me if there's something to be said about children being targeted because they're children. But the question I wanted to ask, even though I'm here, is I also hope we can talk, at least on the margins, about accountability. A number of you mentioned accountability, which I take as at least somewhat of a code word for the ICC, and would be curious how the ICC and its mission can dovetail with the mission of the Security Council in this particular agenda.
Yes, thank you very much. Perhaps I would first react to the comment made by a colleague from UNICEF about denial of humanitarian access, especially in the context of Syria. We have not taken it up so much in the context now of the working group in the PRST, which we adopted in June or June now, conflict about this issue, and we have worked quite a bit on this issue together with our colleagues from Australia and in the context of another PRST, which we introduced in October, which was adopted by Security Council in October, which is on the PST on the humanitarian situation in Syria. And this PST is actually very much focused and has been worked, we have worked very closely with the UN, relevant UN agencies on this issue. And it's a very practical, very focused text, which is looking at all these problems, how to improve access for humanitarian actors, we're completely looking at the issue of bureaucratic obstacles, visas, humanitarian corridors, routes, and so on and so on, making appeals to the government, but also very much for the parties. We also, in this PSD, and I wanted to mention that I forgot it before, we made sure also it has a strong language on the situation and the violation of abuses committed against children in Syria. About the issue on one side of recruitment, but very much also on killing and maiming, on the problem with attacks on schools and hospitals, and also the sexual violence, and I think Mrs. Sarugi referred to that. So you will see there's strong language on this, and also on the issue then on accountability again in the area of in Syria. We couldn't go, we would have loved both of us. We tried hard and it's a very last moment to hold on to our part of ICC. But at least in the Syria context, we have a strong language there on the need to bring perpetrators to justice and to hold them accountable. In the PST, on children and on conflict, there we have, and we briefly mentioned it before, we have language on accountability, on impunity, and also on the ICC. And it is actually, as I said again, it was not easy. It was actually the reason why silence was broken, and we only had an agreement on the text 5 minutes before the meeting started. I had a deputy prime minister sitting there, who was a little bit nervous, you know, had flown in from Luxembourg for the debate, and we had one country who had broken silence, who had a problem with the reference of the ICC. But it has this issue in very much the need to further the fight against impunity and true accountability for genocide crimes against humanity, war crimes, egregious crimes perpetrated against children. It speaks about the complementary role of the ICC, but the big contribution of the ICC, but it also speaks about, and I think this is an issue where we perhaps try, which I also like to work more on next year, very much also on the capacity building, institution building, also on the national level, on the courts and the tribunals, to increase also the possibilities for investigators, prosecutors, assistance in this respect. But so this is an issue, and it had been through the resolutions before. There was a build-up there, there was always a little bit of language before, there was the PPs of the resolutions. Now we have quite a substantial, actually we have two paragraphs on the whole issue of ending impunity and holding perpetrators accountable, one more focusing on the national level and one more on the international role of the international criminal justice system and public mixed tribunals as well as specialized chambers, also national tribunals and then the international criminal court. So I think there we have made leeway, and also in other texts, as you see actually in the Security Council, also there was a very good text in February on protection of civilians in general, where we had also language on children, but also other general protection of civilians. There was also strong language there on ICC and in general international criminal justice system. And so it's making theory, but it's not easy because, again, if you want to preserve consensus, which you need for PLSTs, for example, they by definition have to be adopted by consensus. Obviously, Nessa Bien knows how difficult it can be to get consensus on issues where not everybody is necessary. For the moment, we have a situation in the Security Council, we have 7 states parties, 8 non-states parties, but the US very much on these issues having been aligning also with the states parties. Next year, we will be, for the very first time, Security Council will count 11 states parties out of 15. Members of the council, and so I think that will certainly perhaps also improve our means in this respect.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to ask you elements and make some remarks. The first question of the director of the Research Institute is a very important point. I would say that I have exactly the same, I would say, experience with that, from the same assessment that Leila did. It happened that because I have been in the past before in the council in charge of Africa for many years in Paris, so I know it too well. And each time when I was president of the working group and I was visiting Africa, each time I had raised the question with head of state, which had problem, those elements of the army were still using recruiting. I never had the impression, no one told me this is not completely, this is the way people say that you do not interfere. No. The concern was exactly what they are, I think. This is my experience. And this ministerial debate we had in the country before 1612, which is now history, who asked for this debate? Who was pushing the French delegates? Benin. Why Benin? Because in West Africa, we have Liberia, Sierra Leone, Côte d'Ivoire, all these villages, victims and families, victims and more children than victims. So the sub-regional organization was asking for this war, and it was for territory. So it's really a shared, and I always thought it was a shared concept. Now, question 17, 18, which is, you know, depends on things, depends on society, but this is a shared idea. Now, the second point, which is the ICC, I just want to, I know how difficult it is, data would say, the council, it happened that I negotiated the resolution which had referred the Darfur situation to the ICC, so it took me 2 months, a month and a half to expect. So I think that to address the issue of non-state persistent perpetrators and non-state actors, this is an asset we have. And I would just want to say that all the worry I have introduced in the report last year. I have been introduced after a long conversation with the prosecutor. So it is something which is, you know, and I read it to person, but are very close to the ICC. So on the concrete proposal I have put down to the report. I won't say that. There are two independent bodies, so how to have the ICC and the Security Council without interfering, because they are independent, how they can, the prosecutor and the working group can work together sometimes to have some persistent perpetrators push to sign a plan of action. Because this was the objective I had. It's something which can be done sometimes. But I hope that you will be able to have the press secretary or his deputy or deputy coming to the working room sometimes and explaining, you know, I think to discuss respecting their independence, totally, of course, the independence, what could be concretely some occasions a good. I would say combined, dependent combined action.
Thank you so much for that contribution. Is there a reply from the bench?
Hardly a reply. I just want to comment, though, that the prosecutor has committed to developing a policy next year on children in and affected by armed conflict, which just demonstrates, I think, the importance that she attaches to this issue. And it's one of the reasons why I'm here, really, is because mine is the policy section. And so it's to really try to identify issues and to see how the ICC can work with other actors to try to deal with this issue, as it was pointed out by one of the speakers, that, you know, it can't be done alone by any one of the actors. We all have a small part, some, you know, smaller, bigger parts to play in this. So, you know, we have a part to play, and often I think, you know, the other point about developing capacity on the ground, very important, and we also, you know, if we can get involved to the extent of developing capacity in countries to deal with it, with these violations themselves, that's first prize. We are complementary to states. So, just to make a comment that, you know, Ms. Bansuda, the prosecutor, sees this as really important, and hopefully we would be able to be able to work with other state actors, but to also highlight what Diane said, it would be very useful if in resolutions there is wording that would support accountability, would assist us in our course as well. Thank you.
Something, if you don't mind, because I think that I would like just to let everyone know how important the work for ICC is. Because when you are in the field, when you are in countries that justice is devastated or is not in existence at all, and you are working to ensure that there is some national response that cannot cover everything. And I experienced it in DRC, where you try to have something functioning in area where you don't have even the presence of state. And you have also the ICC as a tool to say, hey, if we cannot reach you because of the weakness of the state, you could be also. And I saw it myself, the Lubanga case, people that did not care in the past. They start thinking about my personally, I could be targeted. So they start saying it's not me and making it clear that this is happening, this is not in my union. So the role of the ICC, specifically when of course our aim is not to use ICC. Our aim is to ensure that you have a national institutional response and you have a justice functioning and you have a country that deal with the problem. And this is the ultimate goal of any role that the UN can play in every space. But you find also today, for example, Central African Republic, there is no justice, there is no police, no military. So you need to have, in such vacuum, you need to have something else that can allow you also to work, to threaten, and to use something. So this is, we need to continue to say that. Second, the major contribution of ICC is the jurisprudence. And this is important for us. And I think that you have to continue to help us, because you have the legitimacy, the legal legitimacy to say this is something that we consider a crime, and also with regard to the how you will deal with the victims and how we can, for example, the reparation process with regard to children that were recruited are victim, not victim. We are discussing a lot of issue on that. So these are, for example, with regard to the role of the witnesses as boys and girls that were also involved and they come to testify. So all these things we need the work that you are doing, and we continue to collaborate and work with you.
Thank you very much. There's at least two more comments from the audience that I wanted to have.